No idea.
Nobody told me. Okay. Merry Christmas. Man, it's a beautiful day out. God's given us a great day. I want to welcome you to our Christmas service. It's going to be a little shortened this morning. So we're going to try to keep you moving so you can get to your family affairs today. Do want to remind you that today's offering is going to be for the year-end for the renovation of the auditorium here. I'm hoping that in these first month or two we have a congregational meeting, can really show you some of the details of what we'd like this to look like in a few months or as soon as we get the monies in. So hope you're praying about that. If you don't have, if you want to give something that goes with this tax year, you have to have it in by Friday. Let's make this morning a morning where we worship the Lord Jesus in a very meaningful way. We have so much to be thankful for. Amen?
Amen?
He's blessed us in such marvelous ways. And we should be excited every day. Every day is Christmas for those who know Christ their Savior. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, Nick, let's do it.
All right, so we're going to sing the last week of Christmas songs here. So go ahead and stand up. And, you know, if at some point you guys get tired and need to sit down, that's fine. But I'm not going to tell you when to sit up and stand up and sit down. We're just going to... We're going to do push-ups and whatever you need. So here we go. The last round of Christmas songs saves some of the nicest ones for last. So let's sing out the first Noel.
The first Noel, the angels we say, was resurgent for shepherds and fields we God.
much greater will our song be
when Jesus comes and rules and reigns and makes this world right. We thank you for your free gift of salvation. May everyone here know the story of God of God becoming man, taking on flesh, becoming the perfect sacrifice. And he can die a sinner's death, though himself being without sin. That those who believe in him and his death and his resurrection could have eternal life. Bless our time together. Bless our time in the Word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Miss, this one? This is always a good time of year for me because 40 years ago, my parents shared a story with me about 4 weeks prior to Christmas and told me about Christ coming to earth to be a baby. And then a few months later, we're going to celebrate his death and resurrection. And he died on the cross so I would never be alone. When I was 4 years old, that story hit hard with me because I was scared of being alone. I remember going to the second floor of my house, sitting on the steps, crying, saying, "Lord, please come in my heart. I don't want to be alone." I celebrated my first Christmas 40 years ago, a new man, a new person, saved. So Christmas is always special to me. So know that Christ did come to save us so we would never be alone. If you open with me to Matthew chapter 1, I'm going to read 18 to 25. Matthew 1, 18 to 25. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as followed. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit. And Joseph, her husband, being a righteous man, and did not want to disgrace her, planned to send her away secretly. But when he had considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child you have conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bear a son, and you will call his name Jesus, and he will save the people from their sins." Now all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophets. "Behold, the virgin shall be with child, and shall bear a son, and they will call his name Emmanuel," which translated means "God with us." And Joseph awoke from his sleep and did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, and took Mary as his wife, but kept her a virgin until she gave birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. The ushers come forward. Turn your attention to the missionaries in focus, the bottom of the order of service. I'm going to take a moment for you to take this opportunity to pray for them, pray for others who are not with us, and what's appropriate on your heart. Let's pray. Lord, I know that it must have been hard to send your son to this earth. And Jesus, it must have been hard to give up your glory, but not hard enough because you did it for us. What love you had for us and compassion on the Son of Man because of what we have accomplished here on earth and what we've messed up. We know, Lord, from Genesis that we're the ones who sinned. We're the ones who disobeyed. We're the ones who violated your commands. But Lord, you sent your son to this earth to die for our sins. You sent him to live among us, to help us understand who you are, to be an example among men, to show us who God is, who our Father in heaven is. Many religions out there try to portray you in different lights and try to make you out something different, a puppet God. But Lord, you are not that. You are the creator of this universe, master of all. You have made us and wonderfully have put us together. Lord, I thank you and praise your name for that. We love you, Lord, especially for this time this season, and we can stop and remember when your son came to this earth to die for our sins. We remember that he was put in a manger so long ago, and that shepherd, a common man, came to worship him. You didn't come among princes. You came upon common people. That shows me, Lord, that you care even for me, a common man. I thank you, Lord, for all the great things you've given us. And Lord, I pray and long for the day that I can celebrate Christmas with you in heaven. I thank you, Lord, for this church, that we can preach your word and tell other people about you. Pray that we'd be a light upon a hill for Pottstown and the world around us. Pray for our missionaries out there in the world. I pray that they'd be celebrating Christmas today in a new and a fresh way. Guide them and protect them. Be with us as people, Lord, that we would just understand who you are. I thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for us. And I worship your name. I worship your holy name. In that I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Dwayne. Dwayne's been singing Christmas songs forever. Hey, why don't you get up and give someone a big Christmas embrace or a welcome? And four, we got every reason to be excited. I come to you this morning battling a head cold. I've been the last 2 days living on Alka-Seltzer. It's wonderful stuff. It tastes like Sprite. So I tell my kids, or how do you get that stuff down? I said, I feel a lot better when I open my head up a little bit. But, you know, this whole Christmas, and it just seems like about every other year, I really don't get sick during the year. It's only at Christmas time. I think it might have something to do with that drive-through nativity, shaking too many hands at the end of this thing or something. I'm not sure what it is, but something about Christmas makes me ill. It's not really good, is it? But you know what? You wait and you plan and you do all this stuff for Christmas, and it seems like it's a long time coming, but it's over very quickly. Did you take notice of that? You know, I'm to that stage where they're not the little kids. But I remember how Christmas was in that morning. You go out, and there's all these presents under the tree. And in a matter of moments, that all is turned down to a sea of wrapping paper, right? And you think, that's it, it's over. You know, that's what you feel, at least, you know. It's nothing left but the cleanup. It seems like, you know, I don't know what all the trash and stuff is those days, but between the boxes and the wrapping paper, it seems like it takes 10 trips to get it all out of your house after a big Thanksgiving. And your whole house is in disarray for a while. Did I say something wrong? Did I say Thanksgiving? See, I told you Christmas makes me ill. But now that Christmas is about over, I know some of you probably still didn't open all your presents yet. But, you know, tomorrow you'll say, okay, what should I, you know, how can I respond to Christmas and keep it meaningful in my life? And we're just going to take some simple lessons again. And this year I kind of pretty much stayed in Luke chapter 2. And we're back there again actually this morning. And this is from verses 17 to 20. And it's speaking about the shepherds. And when they saw it, when the shepherds saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child, Jesus. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. First thing I want to look at this morning is pondering, verse 19. And it's Mary who treasures up all that she's hearing about this babe that she has just given birth to. She's treasuring it up in her heart and she's pondering these things. If you're here last night, you're going to see some things that maybe seem a bit redundant, but things that we need to think about and consider. And of course, always you have to consider to Christmas time the humility of the incarnation. We think of how many times we've heard the Christmas story. Most of you could get up here and tell the Christmas story enough. We've heard it enough. We've brushed up against the truth enough that sometimes you get a calloused heart about it. So calloused, in fact, to the wonders of this story that it can't penetrate our daily life. You know that old saying, which is very true, that familiarity breeds contempt. And sometimes we get so used to a story, you know, we've heard it so often that it doesn't make the impact. We think we know all that there is to know about it. There's a story told about a chauffeur who used to drive a chemistry professor to dozens of speaking engagements. And he'd heard this speech that the professor gave, oh, countless times. And he said on the way to another engagement, he said, "Professor, I believe I could give your speech myself. I've heard it so often." The professor said, "I'll bet you $50 you can't." "You're on," said the chauffeur. He stopped the car and the two exchanged their attire. And they came to the banquet and the chauffeur, dressed in a tuxedo, sat at the head of the table and he was introduced. He stood up and gave the speech exactly as he had heard it so many times before. At the end, there was a standing ovation. The MC got up and said, "You know, we're so fortunate to have a fine resource with us tonight. And since we have a little extra time, let's have some question and answers." Well, the first question was asked, and the chauffeur stood there dumbfounded, clearing his throat in nervousness. Finally, with a flash of insight, he said, "You know, that's just about the stupidest question I've ever heard. In fact, it's so dumb, I bet my chauffeur could answer that. You see, we can know some of the story, but not have the insight that goes with those facts. We need to keep the story of Christmas fresh. We need to make it fresh in our life. We need to remember that Jesus came down out of heaven and took on flesh. The second person of the Trinity, the eternal Son of God. He took on humanity with all of its limitations, with all of its pain and sorrow and suffering. Paul describes it this way. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, he says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich." Anyway, ask yourself and ponder it. What does that mean, he became poor? It means that he gave up his honor and glory. It means that he let go of his position. It means he relinquished all the riches of heaven in order to become one of us. In order to become a man. Perfect man, but a man nonetheless. In order to save us from our sins, he gave up the glory that he had in heaven to become a man. You know, he could have come down to earth as a man, but he comes as an infant. As a baby, think of that. Completely at the mercy of Mary and Joseph. He was unable to feed himself, unable to move about, unable to communicate as a babe. Unable to do anything except what a normal baby does, eat and sleep and dirty his diaper. The Son of God became a person. That's really ironic. Here is the creator of all the universe, dependent upon a man and a woman to take care of him. It says Mary treasured these things up. She pondered in his heart. I wonder what she really understood at this point. Probably very little. She knew what the angel had told her. But there's no way she could have known the impact of all of that. The hands of the one who had formed galaxies and set the stars in place. The hands that had spun the earth on its axis were now in a manger, and his arms were waving about ineffectually. The mouth that had spoken the universe into existence, now babbling and cooing. The sovereign Lord of creation had become the very picture of weakness and powerless and a picture of inability, a little baby. Not a royal baby, but a peasant baby, born to poverty, raised in humble circumstances. He had been surrounded by heaven and the glory of angels, and now surrounded by fallen, sinful human beings in a stinky manger. How did Mary deal with those things? Think about the humiliation. Ponder it. Because as people, when we're struck with a serious illness, we have something that's progressively debilitating. We come to that fact that over time we know that we're going to become less and less able to care for ourselves. One of the things that we fear most is losing control, is becoming dependent upon someone else. And yet here, is the God of all the universe dependent upon fallen parents? That's incredible. Ponder that as you think back on the times of Christmas and how God brought it all about. A virgin teenager becomes pregnant and they have to go to Bethlehem to pay a tax. God is moving all these things to bring about and to fulfill the scriptures. He's born in a feed trough. He's visited by shepherds. The story is just overwhelming. C.S. Lewis said, "We don't need to be told new ideas so much as we need to be reminded of old truths. And to continue to ponder that great truth that God gave himself for us. That he was born as one of us so that each of us might be born into the family of God. That babe who was lying in a manger some 2,000 years ago is the Savior of us all. And yet we are reminded and need to ponder the fact that over and over again, we lose the real reason for Christmas. We forget about the baby. There's a story of a wealthy family in Europe that had decided to have their newborn child dedicated. And they lived in this enormous mansion. Dozens of guests were invited to the elaborate affair. And they all arrived dressed elegantly. And after depositing their coats and their wraps and things in a bedroom upstairs, the guests were entertained downstairs. But eventually the time came for the main purpose of their gathering, the infant's ceremony, his dedication. But where was the baby? Nobody seemed to know. The child's governess ran upstairs, returned down with a desperate look on her face. Everyone is searching frantically for the baby. Finally, someone recalled seeing the baby sleeping on one of the beds, the bed where they had put all of their coats. And there was the baby, covered up, buried in coats, almost suffocated. Why? Because they forgot the main focus of what they were there for. And that's very typical of an American Christmas, isn't it? That we forget that it's all about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's all about this idea that yes, Jesus took on humanity and he was fully human, but he was also completely and fully divine. As he lay in that manger in Bethlehem, he was God. He was God as he grew. He was God as he went through his teen years. He was God as he approached adulthood. He was God when he began his earthly ministry. He was God as he was arrested and falsely tried. He was God when he was falsely convicted of no crime. He was God as they executed him on the cross. He was God while he lay in the tomb. And he was God in that he raised himself from the dead. Jesus came to give himself a ransom for many. And we need to keep pondering that. We need to keep remembering that. And if we do, we're going to praise him. Verse 20 says, "The shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen, as it had been told them." See, these shepherds had the privilege of being present at the world's greatest birth announcement, delivered by the angels, delivered to them in Luke chapter 2. Let me read it for you. You know it, but in verse 10, "And an angel said to the shepherds, 'Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of a great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger.'" You've read those verses maybe hundreds of times. But have you ever focused on that one little word that keeps coming up in those couple verses? You. He did it for you. He says it's a great joy to all people. The angel's message to the shepherds, the angel's message to you and I is that Jesus is your shepherd, that Jesus is your king, that Jesus is your Christ, that Jesus is your gift, that Jesus came straight from God just for you. See, sometimes we focus on the fact that God so loved the world that we forget that God so loved you and me. Jesus came for you. Praise God for that. Without Jesus, we would be without hope. Without Jesus, we would die and go to the grave and be in a lost eternity. Well, listen, folks, you've got to personalize this. You know, one of the things that happens when you go out under the Christmas tree in the morning, before there's the paper thrown everywhere, what's the first chaos? Who does this gift belong to? Right? Which ones are mine? Now you got kids that are like, this isn't mine, this is your sister's. This isn't mine, this is yours. Yeah, where are mine? The ones that have your name on them, right? Jesus is the gift that has your name on it. He came for each and every one of us. But of course we know, in order for a gift to do anything for you, you have to receive it. You know, if you leave that gift wrapped up under the tree and never open it, may be the thing that you need the most in life. But if you don't open it, it won't do you any good. That's the sad thing, that there are so many people out there this morning who haven't seen the real meaning of Christmas. Jesus has his name on them, and they don't open the gift that he's given to them. See, if you know that Jesus came for you and you think about these things, you can't help but respond by praising him. That he came down out of heaven for you. You can't help but worship him. Not just at Christmas time, but all the time. And that's what we desire. That's why I would say, listen, Christmas is an everyday thing for those who know Christ as their Savior. That Jesus came for you. He came to bear your sins, to die on the cross, to be raised again. Because he's raised, we shall be raised also. The third thing here is that he says that they were proclaiming. And when they saw it, that's the shepherds, when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. You know, that is one of the saddest things about Christmas, is the millions of misses that take place. During this Christmas season here in America and around the world, there are millions of trees. There are millions of cards sent. There are millions of carols sung. There are millions of gifts exchanged. There are millions of mentions of the name of Jesus, but there are still millions who are lost because they don't know the real Jesus. They don't know the real reason that he came. There's a little verse in Jeremiah chapter 8, tucked away there, verse 20, that says this. And Jeremiah here is talking about Israel and his lament for them. He says, the harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. And I think of a Christmas pass and the whole nation stops for a couple days here, and yet millions are not saved. Millions of our fellow countrymen, millions of people around the world are not saved, even though they have celebrated Christmas, because they missed him as a Savior. Matthew chapter 1, verse 21, those first announcements. Names of the Lord says to Joseph, Mary will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. You just read it here in Luke chapter 2, verse 11. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ, who is the Messiah, our Lord.
We need to proclaim that truth. We need to make it known to all the world. See, you just get those first couple of verses announcing the birth of Jesus, and you say, there's our Savior. We don't need to look no further. Here he is. Born in a manger 2,000 years ago. Dwelling amongst us ever since. He paid the sin debt. He's redeemed the sinner. He's paid the ransom price. Salvation can be had. It's free to all who will just accept and believe that Jesus is the Savior. More than a great teacher. More than a great story for a holiday season. Jesus came as the Savior of the world. No one needs to be excluded. No one need go to hell. But we need to proclaim that. We need to be like these shepherds who told everyone that they met. Why? Because many are still in the dark. We'll soon be returning to our study in the book of Isaiah. But when we were in Isaiah, do you remember the 9th chapter? Verse 2 says, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwell in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shined. Why? Because verse 6 says, and prophesies there, for unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and of his peace, there will be no end. We have a Savior who came and entered into the realm of time and lived a sinless life and gave himself for us. He's risen again. He's gone up into heaven, but he's coming back for us. He's coming again. That's what Christmas is about. These are things that most of you know full well. But we can't keep these things. Yes, we can treasure them. But we also have to tell. See, and I think there are a lot of Christians today who are like Luigi Tarisio. He was a man who was found dead one morning in his home. Very Spartan home. It was basically empty except for one thing. He had 246 exquisite violins in his possession. He had been collecting them all of his life. He stuffed them into the upper room and the attic of his house. The very best one of those 246 was in the bottom drawer of an old rickety bureau. In his devotion to the violin, he had locked it away. He had kept it to himself. He had robbed the world of all that music. He had treasured these violins up. But he had not let them out for the world to enjoy. And of course, the greatest of his collection was a one-of-a-kind Stradivarius. See, we can treasure and cherish things. But those things need to be told. Those things need to be spread abroad. Those things need to be used. People need to hear those violins. People need to hear to a far greater extent the story of Jesus Christ. The truth. You see, and sometimes I think we act like school kids. We think, hey, you know what? I studied. I got the test right. That guy didn't get it. No, we need to do it. We need to share that message with everyone. And it's not just for pastors. It's not just for missionaries. It's not just for full-time people. It's for everyone. See, the shepherds returned. They went back. They didn't quit being shepherds. They went back to the old life that they had, but they didn't go back to the old living. Why? Because they told people, they proclaimed it. God used them where they were. They didn't keep silent about what they had seen. They didn't keep silent about what God had revealed to them and the truth that they held. They were bold in telling it to all that they met. And that's where we have to be. I wonder if this Christmas season you can examine yourself and say, you know, I've known the truth of Christmas for many years, but do I proclaim it to others? Well, Pastor, I'm not one of those who says happy holidays. I say Merry Christmas. Is that enough? Do you tell them? Do you proclaim it? See, that good news needs to be told. It needs to be proclaimed throughout the world so that people can be delivered from sin and death and hell. Because when the news doesn't get out there, people are destroyed. People are lost. There's many stories of battles fought unnecessarily, especially early in our history when news traveled slowly. During the American Revolution, just for one instance, there was a battle called the Battle of Blue Licks. It was fought at the stream that bears the name Blue Lick Stream. That battle never should have been fought, for it was fought after the war was over. Of course, we know in those days, news traveled slowly. Blue Licks is in Kentucky. There was no quick communication over the Appalachian Mountains at those times, and no one knew the war was over. And people died needlessly because they didn't have the news. In that same way, Christ has won the victory. He won it by entering into this realm of time. He won the victory over evil at the cross of Calvary. All that's left for you to do is to tell the good news, to proclaim it. As we end 2016 and enter into 2017, I want to be a person who ponders the scriptures and all these great truths that have been given to us. And I want to praise God and I want to worship Him. And I want to be a powerful witness in proclaiming the truth of Jesus Christ to all those round about us. And I believe that that's what ought to happen here at Berean, don't you? That's a no-brainer, isn't it? Who could argue with that? Proclaim the truth. Live the truth. Rejoice in the truth. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, how we thank you for your word. These simple truths. Help us to personalize these things. We know that you did it for us. We weren't even born yet, and yet you came. While we're still in our sins, you died for us. Made a way for us. Oh, Father, how we thank you for the good news that is given to us. That Jesus Christ is the Savior of all of mankind. Every race, every creed, every color. A message that's equal to all. Oh, what a world this would be if people would embrace the real, true meaning of Christmas. Father, we know it's our task to go out and to boldly share that truth and to courageously live it out before men. Pray, Father, that we might count it a great privilege to do so, that you might empower us, enable us, and encourage us in it. And we ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Please stand as we sing Silent Night.
Holy infant, so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace.
Before we dismiss you, would you like to know what the building fund offering was this morning? You know, we had desired to see this auditorium converted into a formal sanctuary, and it will be in the Lord's timing. You know that we do not put ourselves in debt here at Berean. We pay as we go. But you better be praising God today, because today we received $127,774.31 so far. And I'm hoping that gets us up near at least the halfway mark on this auditorium, but we're going to hopefully be giving you some more information on that in the very near future, what it could look like, and for the glory of God, right? For the glory of God that we do this. I think we need to give thanks for that. Let's pray. And do you have some kind of little chorus or something?
I do spontaneously have greatest thy faithfulness to say.
Okay, you do spontaneously have that. Well, let's have a quick word of prayer, though. Oh, our Father, how we thank you for your goodness and for your faithfulness and for your abundance, Father. We pray that we might have wisdom and discernment to use these monies, not for anything here to promote ourselves, but instead to exalt and glorify the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you again for that you've blessed us as a people. For those who give so willingly, Father, bless them in all that they do. And we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's sing it out.
Let's spontaneously get the words up on this. Hey, look at that.
Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Father, we are so thankful for your thankfulness. Continue to bless us. Continue to be teach us to be witnesses. We thank you for your gospel story that tells us that you did not come into the world to condemn the world, because the world was already condemned and condemnation was already on us all. But you, being the light of the world, came down and broke through that darkness and showed us your marvelous light. But the darkness wanted to be in the darkness. It hated the light and rejected it. Lord, we want to recognize that we ourselves are sinners. We are unworthy of salvation, but you give us the gift of salvation so freely. All we have to do is believe in you. We believe that you are the very Son of God. We believe that Jesus came down out of heaven, came as a baby, the very month we celebrate, this time of remembering that you coming as a child and then growing, and then as a man having to experience all the things that humans have to go through, being rejected, being crucified, dying in our place, though yourself had no sin. You rose again from the dead, and you come back again. If any believes in that today, they have eternal life, not of anything that they've earned, but because believing in the gift of what you've given us. I ask that you give us the strength and the courage to witness to our families, even today, as we go out and we have our time together. May the Lord bless you and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace and Merry Christmas.